have Abhay Gupta from Harvard, who is going to discuss another neural network architecture for translation factor binding circuit.
All right, hi everyone. I'm Ankit from Harvard. I'm going to be talking about using dilated convolutions for modeling long-distance genomic dependencies. And like you said, I'm going to be talking about predicting genetic markers in general. So this is going to be pretty related to the talk we heard earlier about genetic markers, but I'm going to be talking about sort of a new architecture that came from a different field and discussing how we can use it for predicting genetic markers. So in general, when we're talking about genetic regulation, as we heard before, there are a bunch of different types of genetic markers that we're usually interested in. The reason we're interested in these is there's the regulation of genes in terms of which ones are expressed and what cell types is mediated by the interactions of a variety of proteins with DNA. So the central protein we care about usually is transcription factors, which bind in various regions, such as in this diagram, in the promoter and enhancer regions. There's also histones that the DNA loops around, and chemical modifications to these histones can affect the accessibility of DNA, which then affects more binding behavior. And also there's DNA's hypersensitivity sites, which we also heard about earlier, which are sort of intrinsically accessible regions of the genome. And sort of knowing where these are in different cell types is useful to understanding the binding profiles of the different cell types. So in this talk, I'm going to be talking about how we can go about predicting these. Now in this talk, I'm going to be focusing on just based on the sequence alone, which we sort of heard about some of the limitations of that. But it's worth noting that the architecture I'm going to discuss can be easily expanded to incorporate the other types of inputs that we discussed earlier. So in particular, I'm going to be discussing the challenge associated with capturing long-distance interaction in DNA. So DNA, due to its complex three-dimensional conformation, has this property where elements that are really far along the one-dimensional sequence of DNA can actually be adjacent to one another in three-dimensional space and therefore able to interact. So intuitively, if we're trying to model these regulatory marker locations, it may be useful to incorporate information from very far away along the 1D sequence of DNA, even though that's right next to it in three-dimensional space. Unfortunately, to do this, we have to incorporate a lot more input for every one of our predictions in sequence space. So the question becomes how we scale up models to go about doing this. I'm going to talk about how we can do that using dilated convolutions. In particular, there's sort of two high-level tasks that I'm going to be talking about. The first task is one we've heard a little bit about before. It's essentially a prediction task or some sort of validation task in which we're trying to predict the presence of regulatory elements given raw DNA. So this is given some sequence, predict what are the elements in that sequence or in some subset of that sequence. The task that we're going to sort of demonstrate in this work is more of a labeling task. So this is more along the lines of what we see in computer vision with labeling every pixel in an image, or an NLP with labeling every word in a sentence. And in this case, we're going to say, given some input of some fixed length, predict at every location of that input all of the regulatory markers that are present there. And then obviously, if you can do this really well, you can sort of map that down to the first problem too. So there's been a bunch of existing work on this task. We've heard about a bunch of these already. They're mostly focused on that first task I discussed earlier. So Zoe Dranska in 2015 sort of developed a data set that's really widely used for that task. They also developed a method called DeepC, which is essentially a three-layer convolution with some fully connected layers at the end for it. Kuang and Shi have a really effective method from 2016 that essentially removes some convolutional layers and adds some LSTM layers. Kelly et al. In 2016 used a slightly different data set with a slightly different convolutional method, but ultimately used the same sort of set of deep learning methods that we're going to be talking about. So the point is people have used deep learning, as we've sort of already heard, for this kind of task. But all of these methods involve using very short sequences and making predictions about that relatively short sequence. So we're going to see if we can sort of expand that scope much larger. So in the past, the methods that have been used are convolutional neural networks and recurrent neural networks. I'm going to introduce how dilated convolutions relate to both of these and how they capture some of the benefits of them without some of the drawbacks as they relate to really long-term dependencies in DNA. So this is sort of the classic picture of a convolutional neural network. We've probably seen some version of this. The input, in this case, is a DNA sequence. You can add other things to the input as well if you'd like. Then there's a series of hidden layers and an output. And we're trying to learn some sort of hierarchical, nonlinear mapping from the input to the output. So in this case, the way it works is you can see in this sort of bright blue hidden layer that's based the three nodes below it, T, G, and C in this case. The next hidden layer is based on that same nonlinear transformation applied to the next three, and so on and so on. Then the next hidden layer builds this sort of next level hierarchy, and we do that until we get to the top layer. So the benefit of this sort of convolutional network is when you don't have that many layers, it's shallow, and by shallow, the main benefit of my shallow is that it's very easy to train in this case. With three layers, we don't suffer the problems of vanishing gradients that we'll often see with very deep networks that people work on in other fields. The drawback about this, though, is the receptive field size, the receptive field being the inputs that affect each output, the set of inputs that affect each output, which in this case are the inputs that are in bold here, is proportional to the number of parameters in the network. So it means that if I want to grow this receptive field in order to take account of these really long-term dependencies, I have to proportionally increase the number of parameters, which is not desirable because that will cause overfitting, it makes the models really big and hard to train, and it slows things down. So ideally, we want to be able to expand the receptive field without having to increase the number of parameters, at least not linearly. So one way to do this is using a recurrent neural network, and this is a very common one called LSTM. The pro of this is it has a really large receptive field. So this is how it works. And this is a bidirectional LSTM, where the first layer here is a forward one, and the next one is a reverse one. So in the forward one, we condition first on this input G, and for the next one, we condition both on the next input and that learned hidden state from the previous layer, from the previous node, and we do that for the entire forward sequence. Then we do the same thing in the reverse direction, now starting from the right side and moving towards the left, and then we concatenate the two of them to get our output, So in this case, we see that the output is now dependent on all of the inputs, meaning the receptive field for every output is all of the inputs. So this seems kind of nice. The drawback is that this is a very deep model, because the depth in this case is not defined by the number of layers, but you can sort of think of it as sort of the distance from every input to the output. Which means that even if you use something like an LSTM, which is designed to not face a lot of the problems that other RNNs face, when we're dealing with sequences of the length that are relevant to genomics, which may be tens of thousands in length, this is very difficult to train. And you can come to the poster afterwards if you want to hear some more of the details of why it is, but essentially that's the trade-off that we face with these two models. So we're proposing to use a dilated convolutional neural network, which has in the past been used for image segmentation and recently started to be used for language a little bit as well, which is a wide and shallow network. So in a sense, it captures the beneficial properties of convolutions and of LSTMs as they're relevant for our task. And in particular, this is how it works. The first layer of this works just like a convolution. So this bright blue hidden layer node is based on the three right below it, and we do that for all of the things in the first layer. However, at the second layer, you can see I've added this dilation. Dilation meaning a spacing in the inputs. So now in the second layer, the three inputs that it's dependent on are spaced by a dilation of 2. And we do that for the entire second layer. And for the final layer, the dilation is 4. So as we go up this network, we increase the dilation exponentially. And what that lets us do is, with the same number of parameters as that convolutional network I showed you before, we have a receptive field that's exponential in the number of layers. Which means that our receptive field size is exponential to the number of parameters. So this network and that CNN I showed you earlier actually has the exact same number of parameters, but this model can capture a much wider receptive field, though in a somewhat sparser way. So the question is, intuitively, this would make sense as a model to capture a really long-term dependency, say tens of thousands in length, but the question is, how well does this actually work? So I'm going to talk about a series of experiments we did to try to get some intuitions about how well this architecture will work. So the preliminary task we did is what we call a short sequence prediction. So this is on the exact task that the DeepC authors did and a bunch of others have done. In this case, the input is a sequence of length 1,000, and the output is a set of binary predictions. So there's 919 of them. They consist of a variety of transcription factors, histone modifications, and DNA sites. And the task is to predict whether each marker is present in the subset of an input. And the authors that introduced this, Zoe Karyanska, have this three-layer CNN model. We've also seen a hybrid CNN LSTM model from Huang and Xi. And our goal essentially is to see, can we match the LSTM performance with dilated convolutions, or at least get better than the CNN? So note that because the sequences in this case are very short, especially because there's pooling in the architecture, we don't expect that dilated convolutions are going to have a huge benefit. But the question is, can we do at least better than SNN? Azure CNN and allow us to have some sort of proof of concept first before we scale this up to a really long set of inputs. So this is what the architecture looks like. Our inputs are one-hot encoded, like we saw before. There's a number of convolutional and pooling layers, followed by fully connected layers. And we adjusted the number of convolution and pooling layers as well, between 3 and 6. And we can replace those convolution and pooling layers with dilated convolutions, or with that hybrid convolutional LSTM model that we talked about earlier. So this is what the results look like ultimately. Essentially, we find that the best model remains that LSTM model. In the middle of each of these three, the three groups are transcription factor binding site prediction, histone prediction, and DNA site prediction. The dilated convolutional model does slightly better than the CNN model, though not as good as the LSTM. Now, it's worth noting, in this architecture that I showed you earlier, there's fully connected layers at the end. So in this case, every output is still dependent on all of the inputs. The difference is how these lower layers that consist of either LSTMs or dilated convolutions or regular convolutions capture the interesting hierarchical structure in the input space. So we don't expect, again, here that dilated convolutions will do much better, but this sort of serves as a proof of concept that at least they seem to be modeling some interesting hierarchical relationships over a relatively wide set of inputs. So now we can take this and sort of blow this up. And now we're going to focus this on capturing long range dependencies. So as we heard about earlier, we went with the approach of just modeling kind of the entire genome. And so in this case, our inputs are of length 25,000 at a time. So this is about more than two orders of magnitude larger than the inputs before. The outputs are now nucleotide level labels. So for every label, for every nucleotide, we're trying to predict whether all of the regulatory markers are present there. And we did this for effectively the entire genome. So we had to do some filtering and pre-processing using the same inputs that SOA and Transca did, so that reduced the size to about 2.5 billion nucleotides. But essentially our training data is 2.5 billion by 919. So it's a really large data set that we're using to learn all of these interactions. And the task now is this full genome labeling binary classification task at each nucleotide. And this is what the architecture looks like. We start with an input. We embed it into a higher dimensional space. Then we have a series of convolutions. And then we have fully connected layers applied to each nucleotide. So not across the input, but applied to just the activations of each at each level. So this is also in like computer vision. This is often called a one-by-one convolution. It's a very similar setup. And in this case now, every output only depends on a subset of the inputs. So we can truly compare these different models. And it's worth noting, since the outputs now are really long, they're 25,000 by 919, having a true fully connected layer at the end would be prohibitively expensive. You'd have millions of parameters in just the last layer, so you wouldn't want that anyways. And we can now, again, replace these convolutions with dilated convolutions and with the sort of hybrid convolutional LSTM approach that we saw earlier. So these are kind of analogous to the earlier approach, though in this case we have much longer dependencies. By using an alternative model that's sort of sparser and captures long-term dependencies, we're giving up some of the ability to model that narrow space really effectively. So in this case, that sort of CNN, which captures a really dense model over a narrower receptive field, does better. But to sort of probe this a little bit more, we wanted to look at what exactly was being learned here. So we tried to visualize these receptive fields. And in this case, we took the sort of relatively naive approach, because we hadn't heard about deep lift yet, actually, which we might apply in the future, to sort of visualize what exactly is being learned here. So what we did is we picked elements from our validation set, and we backpropagated an error of one from every true output there, and map the norm of the gradient applied to the inputs. So in this case, you can see, hopefully the color showed up. So in dark blue are the locations of the true outputs, and we sort of cherry picked some examples here. And in black are the norm of the gradient backpropagated to the input. So the width of each of these is 25,000. So you can see in the standard convolution that the receptive field being learned is essentially exactly where the outputs are. In the LSTM, you see that there's two spikes around where the binding site that this is predicting is, but it's also picking up on some light motifs relatively far away. But it's worth noting that most of that gradient, at least the interesting parts of it, are sort of right where those outputs are. Whereas with this dilated convolution, we over and over saw this example of it's actually passing quite a bit of the input space spread across quite a bit of the inputs we give it. So this sort of gives some intuition as to what might be going on with these various factors. If we're trying to predict something that requires looking slightly farther away, we'll expect that a model that can distribute sort of a lot of influence farther away in the input space will be more useful. Whereas a standard convolution, which is essentially looking right at where the outputs are, would do better in something like DNA slides, where a lot of the information you care about, perhaps all of it, is in the space that we're trying to do the predictions. So the main conclusions we have are that sort of, if we're looking at really short sequences, then likely LSTMs are going to be effective. By short sequences, I mean on the order of a few hundred or say 1,000 nucleotides at a time, because that's sort of in the realm of the length of sequences that LSTMs are really good at in other fields, in computer vision and natural language and so on. When we're dealing with these really long sequences, then probably dialect convolutions, they show a lot of promise being able to model this, and I'd be really curious if people apply this to their own tasks to see how they do on different tasks as well. The visualizations we made show that dialect convolutions capture a really long receptive field, and however, it's worth noting that the different regulatory markers are differentially explained by these long-term interactions. So even if we have really big inputs, it's not necessarily reasonable to say, oh, we should just use this dialect convolution. It seems to capture these long-term dependencies well. And we should think about the types of markers we're trying to model and pick our architecture accordingly. So in the future, there's tons of avenues for work to continue with this. We can look at hybrid architectures to see if we can kind of predict all of these markers really well, incorporate some structural data like Hi-C, which can maybe capture some of this three-dimensional information in DNA. We can do kind of SNP analysis and see how individual SNPs affect things like the original DC authors did, or more generally develop better visualizations for what the input space look like and the importance of each of the inputs. And finally, we can see if we can even incorporate some of the amino acid sequences of transition factors and maybe build some sort of model that incorporates both and be able to use that to generalize to, for example, new cell types or new proteins, but that's sort of maybe way out there. And with that, I'd like to just acknowledge my advisor, Alexander Rush, at Harvard, and David Kelly, who is at Broad and is at Calico, who helped some of the biology aspects of this, and also the rest of the people in my group. And with that, we'll open up to questions.
So how did you decide the size of the dilutions? Do you try, are they mostly exponentially increasing, and how many layers? Did you like able to do a proper architecture search?
So we tried to do a fairly extensive architecture search. So we searched between, the paper has more details about the exact parameters, but it was between 3 and 7 layers. It was increasing by a multiple of 3 every time, which is the maximum amount you can increase and still capture the full receptive field. We also tested having optional stride-1 pooling in between, we have even tried having dilated cooling in between to see if that would be able to capture some of the wide range of effects. So we tried a fair amount. We also tried like 400 or 500 different combinations of number of filters and that kind of thing. So it was a fairly extensive search, but I can't claim that it was as much as it definitely could have been, yeah. In terms of the size of inputs we picked, we essentially picked the largest inputs that would fit on the GPU with some other reasonable batch size.
Did you do a similar
hyperparameter
search?
We tried to, yeah. We're pretty confident about the results, especially for that final task. For the preliminary work, we did a much more cursory search just to sort of prove that something was happening. For that final task, where it was sort of our main contribution, we did a pretty extensive search, at least several hundred configurations per model. Yeah. A lot of GPUs.
Remove my stuff. I have a question.
Sure.
Why do you think these long distance biologically, why do you think that they're incorporating the long-range dependencies? Do you think there are something interesting in the distal regions? Did you look at, say, regions around promoters, or did you look at specific, DNA sensitive sites? See what it is that is in this long-range dependencies that's causing this, causing an improvement in your model?
Yeah. So one of the avenues I want to take next is to look at specific sort of biological experimental results that we know we should expect some long-range dependencies. I haven't looked at that specifically yet, but I will say intuitively, we know that DNA is not really linear at all. It's extremely, the three-dimensional conformation is extremely packaged, and we know that there's a multitude of interactions that occur at a physical level that are really important to determining regularity. regulation occurs primarily essentially by things binding to DNA and things changing how DNA is curved, right? So we would expect that knowing, being able to capture the interactions that occur because of that curving would be really informative for predicting these sorts of things, especially for transcription factors, for example, where that picture I had towards the beginning, where the picture at the beginning about where enhancer and promoter regions are. For example, that enhancer region I have at the top of there might be hundreds of thousands of base pairs away. Yet it's critical to knowing, yet being able to detect an enhancer motif will be really informative to knowing a transcriptional activity close by if we can capture what the structure of that area looks like.
So is there any specific reason why you picked 25,000 base pairs?
Yeah, we picked the largest that we can fit on our GPU. That is actually the reason. I'm trying to actually go longer and get at least 100,000. But when talking to Dave Kelly, it seemed like this would not capture all of the interesting interactions, but at least a very large set of interesting promoter and transcriptional pairings, at least, and some enhancer pairings as well. So it seemed like a balance of getting a reasonable batch size and fitting on our GPU, and then also capturing some of the interesting. But yeah, there's not a rigorous size, so I picked 25,000. If you can make a million fit, that would be amazing.
So then do you have an understanding of how things change as you increase the range? Did you try it smaller values?
To a degree, yes. So at the beginning, we tried with shorter ones and tried with about 5 or 10,000. And essentially, the goal of what we were trying to do was to capture how these, two things. One way in which we capture shorter-term dependencies is by reducing the width of our dilations themselves. So essentially, we can pass an input of 25,000, but only look at, say, 500 or 1,000 of it by picking dilation convolutions with smaller filter widths. So effectively, we were testing that, and what we found is that the filters that were really wide tended to do really well. So that comes from a number of factors, but one of which is likely true is that we just actually do want to capture something.
Any more questions?
Hi there, thank you very much. I had a question. Could these kind of analyses be used to actually predict a DNA folding, or at least figure out what kind of regions in the chromosome are close to other regions? And if so, could those be fed back into the model to kind of make structured priors that help you make even better predictions, perhaps less potential for overfitting?
Yeah, so one of the, when I mentioned at the end high C, that's sort of what I was thinking. I have sort of relatively unformed ideas about how I can use it, but something along the lines of using this as an input and the high C data as a potential output, I haven't exactly figured out what that mapping would look like, but effectively high C gives us a distance between every pair of points in the genome. That's sort of a rough estimate of what it gives us. So if we can use this to predict sort of what that high C output would be, like essentially look at every set of pairs and use something like this as the network that predicts that sort of that distance metric, that would be really interesting. And then fed back to the network that we suggested, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, so for high C, a useful dilation would be something we use a Siamese architecture. So we do dilations with, so each of your units is dilated, but we just have a Siamese architecture which models pairs.